So I'd like to talk about non-locality as well, specifically temporal non-locality. Yeah. And in temporal is time. And earlier you mentioned the problem of time. And then here we're talking about the arrow of time, yeah, or the thermodynamic mm-hmm. arrow of time. So it sounds to people who know some physics that, oh, there's a problem of time. Is that the problem of the arrow of time? Is the problem of time different than the arrow of time problem? And does the second law solve it? All of these get entwined in their mind. So why don't you distinguish those? What is the yeah. problem of time? Mm-hmm. What is the arrow of time and what it has to do with the second law?
Yes. So the arrow of time usually refers to the fact that, you know, in the world as we experience it, there are all these temporal asymmetries, you know, glasses break and don't usually recompose themselves, all of these kinds of obvious asymmetries that characterize our lives. And the problem of the arrow of time is that the underlying physics mostly seems to be time symmetric. So in that sense, it's not obvious where all of these asymmetries could come from. You seem to have to impose them by just deciding by fiat that the initial state of the universe is some special kind of state which can explain those asymmetries. But for many people, that's not super satisfying. The problem of time in quantum gravity is a distinct issue. It refers to the fact that within a specific technical formalism for quantizing gravity, when you perform that quantization, you find that time evolution ends up being what's called a gauge transformation, which means that it's not physically real. It's just kind of giving two different descriptions of the same thing. So it looks like time evolution in the ordinary sense is not present at all. So that leads to a problem of trying to understand, you know, where do our experiences come from? Why do we have these experiences that feel like they are temporal in nature? So they are separate problems, but I think it's very likely they are linked. I think certainly the story about why we have experiences which are temporal in nature must have something to do with thermodynamics and the fact that we live in this very asymmetric regime. So, you know, there's still work to be done to flesh out the connections between these things, but certainly I think they're not completely independent.
So some people explain the arrow of time with coarse graining. I think Stephen Wolfram does this.
Yep.
And in coarse graining is the notion of renormalization. You had a paper on why reductionism is false, or at least not necessarily true, and you tied it to renormalization.
Yep.
Can you please talk about that?
Yes. So in that paper, you know, this is sort of an exploratory paper. I'm not necessarily committed to the view that that reductionism is false, but I'm interested in whether that is maybe one way to try to resolve some of the problems that we encounter in quantum field theory. You know, so one of the problems is a sort of fine-tuning issue where we find that in certain kinds of cases, it seems that the values of two distinct fundamental constants must be very carefully adjusted to fit each other in order to produce the observed value of the constant at a higher scale. And sort of the observation I was making here was that if you say things are the other way around, if you say that the higher level constant is fundamental and the smaller scale constants are in fact derived from it, that gives you a very natural explanation for why they're fine-tuned in this way, because they are in fact fixed by the actual value of the higher level constant. So the thought there was just that perhaps changing our way of thinking such that in some cases smaller scale things are explained by larger scale things rather than vice versa might be a way of understanding some of those phenomena. It was important to look at the renormalization transformations, because renormalization is the transformation we use in quantum field theory to move between different scales. And so the question I was looking at there was trying to understand, given the mathematical structure of the renormalization translations, is it possible that things could be reversed in direction and that the higher scale things could define the lower scale things and not vice versa?
Mm-hmm.
We normally wouldn't think that's possible in sort of more ordinary physics, because we think there's a sort of many-to-one mapping where many microscopic possibilities get mapped to one macroscopic possibility, so the macroscopic possibility can't determine what's going on in the microscopic scales. But renormalization is, in fact, a one-to-one transformation. So it does seem more plausible in the kind of regime where that's relevant, that perhaps the higher scale things could determine the lower scale things because of the specific mathematical structure of that transformation.
Even at fixed points?
So fixed points are somewhat more complicated because fixed points do involve scenarios where many solutions get mapped to one solution. But the thing about fixed points is that they can occur both at very small scales and at larger scales. So it's not obvious to me that invoking fixed points particularly favors one direction of explanation since they occur at both levels.
So let me see if I can phrase this in the language for mathematicians, and correct me if I'm incorrect. The renormalization group is a set of tools to determine how parameters change with different scales, whether it's energy scales or length scales or what have you. Now, it's less of a group in the algebraic sense and more a set of tools, but if it was to be something like a group, it would be a monoid because not every element is invertible. However, most of the elements are invertible, and this would mean that you don't privilege some scale as being more fundamental in the same way that in an affine group, you don't have a privileged origin.
That's right. Yeah. So we have various approximations we use to do renormalization, and many of those are not invertible. But there are good reasons to think that the real underlying transformations should be invertible. And if that's the case, then outside of fixed points, you can go from small scales to large scales, or you can go from large scales to small scales. It's kind of the same from the point of view of the underlying math. And so there's no sort of obvious sense in which the physics is telling you the small things must explain the big things and not vice versa.
Let me see if I can make another analogy. So let's imagine there's a bird in the sky and you take a snapshot of that bird. Mm-hmm. And then you say, okay, its position is here and its velocity is here. So, or its momentum. And then you could say, okay, where is it going to be? And then you can plan out its, or you can predict its trajectory. And then you say, well, look what we got here as an initial position and velocity. But why did you call this initial? Like you could actually, from another point, make the trajectory go backward. And so you have the whole trajectory. So what is the initial point? Why is one point being privileged?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great analogy, you know, because I would say much the same about time evolution as well, that there is no particular reason to privilege one point. Certainly the physics doesn't tell you you have to do that. And yeah, I think the same is true, at least for many applications of the renormalization transformation. The physics doesn't seem to be telling you that the smallest, most fundamental scales must actually be privileged in that sense.
So let's get to non-locality. There's a large hubbub about non-locality and Bell's theorem and also realism.
Yeah.
Well, what is non-locality?
Yeah, so in the context of quantum mechanics, non-locality is the phenomenon that quantum mechanics exhibits correlations which seem to be too strong to be explained by any local model. So, you know, normally when we see correlations at a distance, we would expect to explain them by some common cause in the past. You know, they both came from the same source or something like that. But Bell's theorem demonstrates that the types of correlations we see in quantum mechanics can't be explained that way. It seems as though there's some kind of direct influence between events happening at a distance that can't be explained in this sort of common cause way.
Now, there's two different types of non-locality, spatial and temporal. And you have many papers, many talks as well on temporal non-locality. So please distinguish the two.
Yeah, so perhaps the traditional way of thinking about non-locality in quantum mechanics is to imagine it as a spatial form of non-locality. So that involves, you know, a situation in which perhaps Alice performs a measurement in one location, and as soon as she does that, the wave function collapses everywhere in the world, and that sort of conveys information across to Bob wherever he is, and that has an impact on the result of his subsequent measurement. So that non-locality is spatial because the effect of what Alice does is just transferred to the whole global state everywhere at the same time. Whereas temporal non-locality suggests that non-locality doesn't necessarily have to be conveyed immediately in terms of the current state of the world. You can potentially think of non-locality as kind of hopping across time as well. So Alice performs her measurement at some time, and at some other place and at some later time, Bob performs a measurement, and there's just a direct relationship. There's some kind of constraint requiring that Bob's outcome reflects Alice's choice in some way. So there's a kind of direct non-local impact that is not mediated by a global state evolving forward carrying that information.
Does spatial non-locality imply temporal or vice versa?
Yes. So I think combining spatial non-locality with relativistic constraints makes it very compelling to think that there should be temporal non-locality. That's because if you take a frame of reference within relativity, a relativistic setting where you have a spatially non-local effect, you know, something Alice does influences something that happens over here, you're allowed within relativity to make a change of reference frame to get another equally valid reference frame. And in that reference frame, those events are not going to be at the same time anymore. The event, Bob's event over here, is going to be either in the future or the past of Alice's observation. So it looks like by making that transformation, you have turned your spatial non-locality into temporal non-locality. So that in that sense, if you sort of, if you believe what relativity tells us about the close connections between space and time, it seems very hard to maintain that non-locality is always spatial and never temporal.
As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts, from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.